Hello everyone, today in the class of EE359, that is theory of electrical machines, we will start with the AC machine part. And as you can see, the first one is classification of AC motor. This is given in our textbook, that is in B.L. Thereja volume 2, number 1 textbook, B.L. Thereja volume 2. So if we come to B.L. Thereja, the starting portion is AC, and there is one chapter named induction motor. You can see chapter number 34. Okay, this chapter number 34, this is the portion for AC machines, that is topic in your course plan, that is 16, 17, 18, 19. This is from this chapter. So we will start with chapter 34. So we can see the first topic, classification of AC motors on the basis of different things, it is given, and it is the first topic of chapter 34. So classification of AC motor, this today we will start. So coming to chapter 34, this is induction motor, this chapter we will do. The first one, we can see classification of AC motor on the basis of principle of operation, number 1, number 2 is type of current, number 3 is speed, and number 4 is structural feature. Depending upon this, how AC motor is classified, that is our first topic. So from here we can see the classification of AC motor, and the first thing is based on the principle of operation. We can see classification of AC motor, the first one is on the basis of principle of operation. So at the basis of principle of operation, they are mainly divided into synchronous and asynchronous type. Okay, and synchronous motor again can be divided into two parts. Number 1 is plane, and number 2 is super. And asynchronous can be classified into two terms. One is induction motor and another is commutator motor. And the induction motor is again divided into two parts. First one is squirrel cage, it is again single or double. And second is slip ring, that is external resistance. In case of commutator motor, we can divide it into six parts. The first one is series, this can be single phase, universal, Second one is compensated. Again, it can be conductively or inductively. Third one is shunt. It can be again simple or compensated. And the fourth one is repulsion. It can be again straight and compensated. The fifth point is repulsion start induction, and the sixth is repulsion induction. So this is the basis of principle of operation. Now coming to second point, if we can see classification of AC motor based on type of current. So this is number 2. On the basis of type of current, it is single phase or three phase. Only these two type of classification is there. Next is based on speed. So on the speed, basis of the speed, it is three type: constant speed, variable speed, adjustable speed. And number 4 is structural feature. On the basis of structural feature, so this is the types: open, enclosed, semi-enclosed, ventilated, pipe ventilated, and reverted frame eye, etc. These are the types. Next is working principle of induction motor. So it is given in chapter 32.2. okay, so we already know that the induction motor has, or any motor has, two part, that is stator and rotor, that we know. So here we'll start with induction motor. And we can see, as a general rule, conversion of electrical power into mechanical power takes place in the rotating part of an electric motor. In DC motor, the electric power is conducted directly to the armature, that is rotating part, through buses and commutator. This we already know. Hence, in this sense, a DC motor can be called a conduction motor. However, in AC motor, the rotor does not receive electrical power by conduction but by induction. So here we can see the main difference for a DC conduction type, because by commutator it is directly given to the rotor part. But in AC, the power supply to the rotor part is generally given by induction. It is the primary difference between DC and AC. So we can say, however, in AC motor, the rotor does not receive electrical power by conduction but by induction, in exactly the same way as the secondary of a two winding transformer receives its power from the primary. That is why such motors are known as induction motor. In fact, an induction motor can be, we can see, that is, the conduction and induction is the difference of how power is supplied. So we are in this part. However, in AC motor, the rotor does not receive electrical power by conduction but by induction, in exactly the same way as the secondary of a two winding transformer receives power from the primary. That is why such motors are known as induction motor. In fact, the induction motor can be treated as a rotating transformer. That is, one in which primary winding is stationary, but the secondary is free to rotate. All of the AC motors, the polyphase induction motor is the one which is extensively used for various kinds of industrial drives. It has the following main advantage, also has some disadvantages. Next we will come to the advantage and disadvantage part. So up to this we can see that in a transformer, what is given from primary to secondary, in a transformer there is no direct electrical connection. The flux is provided from primary to secondary via a common core, and the flux is produced in the primary by the primary signal, primary applied voltage, what we can say, and the produced flux goes to the secondary and it is again converted to secondary voltage as per the current ratio that we know. The same thing is done in the case of induction motor, that is a primary which is stationary primary transformer, and the secondary part is here we can see the rotor. So the voltage supply to the rotor is not done by directly, that is which is done in case of DC motor, it is done by commutator conduction type. Okay, by commutator it is done, but here it is done in the case of induction. Next we will do this thing. Next topic is advantages and disadvantages. So advantage, you can see 5 advantages there. It has very simple and extremely rugged, almost unbreakable construction, specially squirrel cage type. So it can be used rough and tumble. It is a advantage. Number 2, its cost is low and it is very reliable. So low cost, that is also advantage. It has sufficiently high efficiency. In normal running condition, no brushes are needed. Brushes are needed in DC motor to provide the power supply to the rotor. But here we don't supply the power directly, that is no electrical connection is there. So brushes is not needed. Hence frictional losses are reduced. It has a reasonably good power factor. Number 4, it requires minimum of maintenance, very good. Number 5, it starts up from rest and needs no extra starting motor and has to be synchronized, has not to be synchronized. So no extra controlling is needed in this case. Its starting arrangement is simple, specially for squirrel cage type motor. So specially squirrel cage type motor has more advantage among the all AC kind of motor. Now it has some disadvantages also. Its speed cannot be varied without sacrificing some of its efficiency. So if we need variable speed, then it has some disadvantage, but if we need constant speed, then it is very good. Just like DC shunt motor, its speed decreases with increase in load. So increase of heavy load, it is not that much suitable, or speed will less. Its starting torque is somewhat inferior to that of a DC shunt motor. So that's the disadvantage. Now next topic is our construction of induction motor.
stator and rotor. So
here is the construction part. An induction motor consists essentially of two main parts, stator and rotor, that we all know, because DC motor also has the same kind of two part. Now we'll see one by one. Now first is the stator. The stator of an induction motor is in principle the same as that of a synchronous motor or generator. It is made up of a number of stamping. So this is the stator part, we can see here. Which has slotted to receive the windings. The stator carries a three phase winding and is fed from a three phase supply. So you can see it's a three phase supply is given. It is known for definite number of poles, the exact number of poles being determined by the requirement of speed. Generator, the number of poles lesser the speed and vice versa. So it is also given in 34.6 that the stator winding, when supplied with three phase current, produces a magnetic flux which is of constant magnitude but which revolves or rotates at synchronous speed, and it is also given by this formula, n is equal to 120 m per b. The revolving magnetic flux induced an EMF in the rotor by natural induction. This is the diagram you can see. Completely tuned stator for an induction motor, and this is the rotor part. Unwound stator with semi-closed slot. Lamination are of high quality and low loss silicon steel. So both kind of stator is given in this point by the figure and. Excuse me, the second thing is rotor. So rotor can be of two type: squirrel cage motor. Motors employing this type of rotor are known as squirrel cage induction motor, and number two is phase wound on wound rotor. So motors employing this type of rotor are variously known as phase wound motor or wound motor or as slip ring motors. And rotor of two type, squirrel cage and phase wound. So both of them are given here, that is 34.4, it is squirrel cage rotor, and 34.5, this is phase wound rotor. So these two is given with diagram in this. And just let me tell you from where these two study. Production of rotating field, two phase supply with mathematical proof. So this we can see, it is given in 34.6, that is production of rotating field. So this is production of rotating field. And this is the mathematical proof. So I am just telling you from what to read. Production of rotating field, two-phase supply with mathematical proof. And next part is slip. So slip is little bit later. This part is production of rotating field. This for two-phase supply, and this is for three-phase supply. And this is mathematical proof of three-phase supply. This is the slip. So slip is given in 34.10. This is the description of slip, and this is the mathematical expression of slip. Now we'll back to this part, that is the construction part. Rotor, squirrel cage rotor. So we can see this is the diagram of squirrel cage rotor with copper bars and alloy brushes end ring, and this is the figure of rotor with shaft and shaft and rings. So start with this spiral cage rotor. Almost 90% of induction motors are spiral cage type, because this type of rotor has the simplest and most rugged construction imaginable, and it is almost squirrel cage type if we use, okay, at any environment, that means it does not need any kind of sophisticated environment, that is sophisticated control is not needed. It can be used roughly as it is, and no more, I mean the maintenance need of this is also very less. So that we can see, almost 90% of induction motor are squirrel cage type, because this type of rotor has the simplest and most rugged construction imaginable, and it is almost indestructible. The rotor consists of a cylindrical laminated core with parallel slots for carrying the rotor conductors, which it should be noted clearly, are not wired, but consist of heavy bars of copper, aluminium or alloy. So wire is not there, okay, bar is there. One bar is placed in each slot, rather the bars are inserted from the end when semi-closed slots are used. The rotor bars are braced or electrically welded or bolted to two heavy and short circuiting end rings, thus gives us what is so picturesquely called a squirrel cage construction. It should be noted that the rotor parts are permanently short circuited on themselves. Hence, it is not possible to add any external resistance in series with the rotor circuit for starting purpose. The rotor slots are usually not quite parallel to the shaft but are purposely given a slight skew. So we can see it is not directly parallel, it is not like this, it is like this. This is useful in two ways. It helps to make the motor run quickly by reducing the magnetic hum, and it helps in reducing the locking tendency of the rotor, that is the tendency of the rotor teeth to remain under the stator teeth due to direct magnetic attraction between the two. In small motors, another method of construction is used. It consists of placing the entire rotor core in a mold and casting all the parts end ring to one piece. The metal commonly used is an aluminium alloy. Another form of rotor consists of a solid cylinder of steel without any conductor or slots at all. The motor operates depends upon the production of eddy current in the steel rotor. So note is there, you can see other results of skew which may or may not be desirable are increase in the effective ratio of transformation between stator and rotor, increased rotor resistance due to increased length of rotor parts, and increased impedance of the machine at a given slip, and number 4, increased slip for a given torque. So up to now we have came up to the construction of AC motor, okay? And we will continue next time. Thank you.